Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. Episode, is it three or four? Where are you anyway?
I got my tea. I got my sausage dog cup.
Take it to your left. Come on.
Can you see him?
Yes.
Look at him.
Is that Jake's dog?
That's that mini. He's a pain in the nuts, that dog at times. Yeah, I got my sausage dog cup. Missus just made a nice cup of tea.
Oh, look, I've got one here as well, look.
Three.
Ready for another long question and answer?
Chocolate mug. Ooh. But yeah, everybody, hope you're all okay. Sun's still out. Itching to get on the bank. I've actually started doing a bit of prep.
Have you?
I have done a little bit of prep. I've done the garden. I've cleaned a couple of the kids' bedrooms out, or got them to clean their own bedrooms out. So I'm running out of things to do. So I've actually done a bit of prep the last couple of days.
This obviously is new, isn't it? Incoming
it is.
Anytime soon.
Yeah.
And look, I've even started doing a bit myself, Des. It's been there for every episode.
I've got mine, and I'll show you inside.
For that, Des.
I've actually done nothing. I'm going to leave that. I've got the labels ready. Look.
Oh, I could have borrowed your labels. Look.
But yeah, I could actually. Actually, I've got some little links now I could put in here. But no, at the moment, I've got it all there. It's all ready to go. I've just not got around to putting the hooks in it.
Well, I've had this on my desk for weeks now, threatening to put something in it, so I've finally done it.
Yeah, I've seen it. It's just like collecting dust, but now you're actually doing something.
Yeah. So anyway, should we get on with the business?
Yeah, fire away with the... We've got loads, haven't we, again?
Oh, even more this week, so it's great.
Try and do as many as we can.
Right then, Desmond.
I've got some bits and pieces. Well, as many bits and pieces as I can to hand, so hopefully... whatever questions come up, I'll obviously try and answer them.
Amazing. Right, first one, Marley Cook. Hi, Des. Please, can you talk us through how important it is to have more than one swim going? I feel a lot of us miss out on a lot of fish, without any disrespect to anyone, by fishing one swim and staying in it all day, especially when the fishing is hard. Now, I think this is definitely a question for you.
Yeah, it is. You, wherever you go, and anybody who's watched any videos that we've done, it's really important you have two lines going, no matter what sort of fish you're doing, really. You know, feeder fishing, yeah, you can fish short and long. Sometimes you can have two lines, like one in front of you off to an angle. But no, we're talking about pole fishing, really. A classic example is, some of the venues I go to, even if I'm fishing for silverfish, I have two lines. I might have a positive line, or I might not start on that. I'll give you a classic example. If you go to somewhere like Viaduct in your silverfish fishing, you have two ground bait lines and you might have a short caster line. So your short caster line, you might start on it if the weather's quite nice. You think, well, I'll nick a few fish there first, depending how cold and that is. But I might have one ground bait line in front of me. Normally in front of me, my positive line is, because if that's where I'm going to catch a lot of my fish, I want to be fishing out in front of me. It's easy to ship back. You know, it's a lot easier to fish. I might put like five balls of ground bait in there with whatever you decide to put in. And off to an angle, like 2 o'clock, try and find the same depth so you don't have to pick a different rig up. That's what I try and do. Because I want to try and drop straight in on one rather than coming back, picking another rig up. You can't always do that, but that's what I try. And I might only put one ball in on that because I might have to go in on that really, really early. You know, if I come short and I can't catch nothing, my next line is where I've put one ball in. And that keeps your options open. And that's just a classic example of why it's so important. You know, what you don't, if the fish were feeding really, really heavy, you might go on your sort of your main line and catch immediately. But there's a lot of occasions when they might take 40 minutes to an hour plus to come over that main feed before. And sometimes you don't want to catch them immediately. You want a pile of fish to come in your peg, get them all settled. And when you go in there, you can catch them really well. And then you can obviously top up and try and keep catching. But it's really, really important you do that. Another venue I've been going, Ivy House on the new lake, even on the old lakes, so important that you prime up another line. Like I said, whether that's short, not catching many fish short before the sort of the thing that's just happened. But you had two long lines. One you were concentrating on because you were getting bites. But every like 20 minutes, you just put a little ball in, whatever that was, whether that was micros or ground bait. And that would be the line where your main line would start to dry up. you could go on there, and sometimes that ends up being, you can reverse it. That can be your line that you're concentrating on, where the line you started on, which the one that's dried up, is it just gets worse. And that's why it's so important. You can feed two lines, if not several lines.
You are a master at that, Des. I always think, a lot of inspiration from how you fish, because you keep lots of things going.
Yes.
Yeah, keep yourself busy all the time.
Yeah, sometimes you come home from fishing a match, you think, I should have just concentrated on one line all day. But I would say 80+% of the time, unless you'd have had those other lines, you wouldn't have won your section and you wouldn't have framed in the match.
And it's not very often one swim works all day, is it?
No, not very really. Rare. Not really. So it's so important, I have made mistakes. We all make mistakes. That's why we go fishing. You can never go to a venue unless you go there every day of the week and you know it that well and think, right, that's the way I'm fishing, because I know that works. Mm. I go to all sorts of different venues and them other lines, even surface fishing, I might just chuck a few casts down the edge and think, well, I might catch. And then all of a sudden your long lines all go a bit funny. You drop down the edge and you catch a big perch. You might get, an odd big roach. And that extra £2 at the end of the match is huge. And it's no different where you're carp fishing or F1 fishing. So important you get into it. Yeah. And then just try and work it out as you go. If the match is going really well, feed them lines. You don't have to go on them. I think some people make a mistake and think, oh, I've got to go on that because I've fed it. You don't have to fish it. If everything's going to plan out in front of you or wherever you're fishing, feed them, but don't go on them. If you don't need to go on them, don't bother. I think people get confused sometimes and think, oh, I'm catching well out there, but I'll have a go down there now. Not be funny. If you're catching well, stick with it.
Yeah.
So it's not, the things I'm looking for is if I can't catch or if I'm not catching the right fish, if there's loads of little fish out long, and obviously I want to try and catch them short because it's a lot quicker. So all that sort of something to think about as well.
But definitely really, multiple lines, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
Next one, Jamie Taylor. Des, why do you use the GPM hook for banding hard pellets and not the KKM?
Well, we spoke about that before. The KKM for me is obviously, I used to use it a lot for pole fishing and feeder, well, mostly feeder fishing, to be honest. But then we sort of developed the GPM. And the GPM for me, when we developed it, it was just looked dead right for pole fishing. It was like what I wanted and what most of the consultants wanted. It was smaller, which was better for catching probably F1s. And the KKM for me now is basically of my feeder hook. And I do use it on a pellet wagger because it's a wider gape. And I prefer a wider gape for that style of fishing. Where the GPM for me, I don't know, it just suits my pole fishing. If I'm going F1 fishing shallow with banded maggot or 4mm pellets, it just seems dead right. They're slightly smaller, not such a wide gape, which is what I like that for pole fishing. And that's it really. That was what it was developed for, was basically pole. Even though people are fishing them on the feeder, I ain't got a problem with that. But the KKM for me is the ultimate feeder hook, and the GPM now is my go-to, whether I'm fishing a hair rig with a eye hook or whether I'm fishing a spade end hook. They're the sort of hooks that I use. I've got them all in here, everything pre-tied, all the pre-tied ones are in there ready to go. They don't get any easier. And they're great hooks, like a big spade. So if you tie them yourself, they're easy to tie. You can get 0.17 on like a 14, and they're just right for like what we're doing in fishing.
Fantastic hooks, aren't they? That is like the classic commercial shape now, isn't it? I'd say.
Yeah, that hook sort of shape's been about quite a long time, but obviously we've changed it slightly, made the spade bigger on the spade end hooks, which is so important. A lot of the older hooks that probably I used to use before Preston even brought hooks out, the spades were just slightly too small, and you sort of tie lines on them and think, God, you're on the critical there. And I'm quite good at tying hooks, and I used to think, well, if I'm sort of like that, tie my own hook, there must be a lot of people thinking I can't tie line on that. So we kept the spades quite big, because it suits what you want to do and what lines that you're going to be tying them on. So there's a lot, you know, there's a lot more things than a hook development than what people think. It's not just like saying that's what we want. You know, we do try and make it sort of fish friendly, you know, friendly for people what to do. You know, if you want to tie your own hooks, they're easier to tie because the spades are nice and big.
Nice question that. Ed Staples says, hello Des, all the years you've been fishing for Preston Innovations and all the great kit you've been able to use, what is your favourite piece of kit from Preston, past and present?
Oh, it's a difficult one that, Ed. There's loads, isn't there? It's got to be the ICS feeder system for me. You know, it's so, I've caught so many fish. You know, we had the flatbed method that obviously Andy Finley produced all them years ago. I've still got some of the original ones that we used to have. And I remember sitting in a meeting and where's my feeders? I remember sitting in the meeting. We had a good feeder anyway. And I said, look, why don't we, I ain't got any of the old ones here. I'll do it on the little one. But the old one, basically, that's the new ICS. And the old ICS was made of plastic. It was metal or lead bottom, but plastic top. And the gap was off. It was here at the back. And I remember saying at the meeting, why have we got the gap at the back? Why don't we have the gap in the middle? That's where everybody wants to put their bait. And that's obviously the new ICS. That's how it come out. And since we've done that, it's like I just catch so many fish on it, you know, whether I'm fishing with pellets or ground bait. So for me, that's got to be my best ever product. You know, you can see it's changed over the years, but for me, it's just a great product. You know, it's easy to fish with. It's easy to change from pellet feeder, different size feeder, different weights. It catches tons and tons of fish. So yeah, that's my favourite product. What's the other? What was the other one? It's the ICS feeder system.
That is innovation at its best, isn't it? That
innovation at its best. Yeah,
I agree with that one. Carl Rogers wants to know. This is quite a nice one. What's the best way to hook worms to ensure they stay on a barbless hook?
Yeah, that's quite difficult. I mean, if you look at any of my videos, I always say. I normally hook the worm through the head. So I get the worm. I actually got a worm.
He's got a worm, hasn't he?
Most of them are drying out. Oh, yeah, they're all right, actually.
Yeah, mine are all right. I checked them yesterday.
Right. I'll actually show you. Let me get a hook out of a second.
They'd be like lobworms by the time we can go out again.
They'd either be one or the other. They'd either be like lobworms or they'd be completely destroyed. They might have to go out for the hedgehogs. So I've got a 16 hook. Now what I normally do, I try and make this... Poor worm, don't deserve this really, does he? He's not even fishing.
Right.
You see
just
that?
There, that's perfect.
So... what I do is just squeeze the worm a little bit. So it's like hooking a maggot. If you squeeze any maggot or worm, it keeps it still. These are cold, so they're still anyway. But if they were warm, if you were out fishing with them at the moment, they'd probably be going mental. But if you squeeze them a little bit and then hook the worm head, probably like 2 or 3, 4 mil down through the head, like that. So it's just through. But it sits dead straight. Can you see that, Joe?
Yeah, perfect.
Dead straight. That's the most important thing. It is straight. What you don't want to do is have it sitting on angles because then it sort of hooks itself, doubles up. And then depending on what size piece of worm you're using, once I've hooked it like that, I can then go along and think, right, I want a piece an inch long. If you've got a set of nails like I have, it's not too bad, but you might have to use scissors, and just nip that off, chuck that out for the hedgehog. And then just pick what size you want. But that's the most important bit, is hook it through the head. Some people go down through the head and out the side. But if I can get away with it, I hook it like that every time, whether that's a full worm or like little pieces like that. And if you hook it like that, I find that's the best way.
Nice. There's loads of hook showing there, isn't there? Loads of hook showing.
And you get away, as like I said, with worms. You know, so unfortunately, if we were out worm fishing now, the fishing would be brilliant on worms. They normally are before they spawn. And that's the nice thing about worm. You can catch lots of fish on worms. And also, you can normally get away with bigger hooks and heavier lines with worm fishing for some reason. They just seem to have it better. Mm. Where with like pellets, that they can all be a bit funny sometimes.
We like worms, don't we, Des? We like worms.
Yeah, it's great fishing. You just get a rag, clean that mess off. That's like a what, like about worm fishing, where you get all messy.
Just proper fishing, isn't it? You can have a bit of float showing and striking.
That's the best way. Hook it like that. Some people, like I said, you can hook it down through the head and out the side, but I try and hook it like that as much as I can, and it normally keeps it on the hook better.
Awesome, awesome. Right. All right.
16 up, really.
16, yeah. What, GPM?
GPM or SFL, depending on what you're fishing for. Silverfish, an odd F1 SFL. You start fishing for more carp, go on to the GPMs. 015, 016, hook lengths.
Right, the next one is from Pete Whitten. He says, Des, on rivers, would you use a maggot feeder or a cage feeder? And if you were using a cage feeder, what ground bait would you use?
Well, obviously, if you go somewhere like, oh, you know, if you, I just use my river as an example, like the Bristol Avon, there's lots of bream in that river. And they do see more and more pellets now. There's a lot of carp in some of these rivers. Most rivers have got carp in, and there's more and more carp anglers. You might not see them because they're pretty crafty. They go down there, they don't tell anybody, but they are laid, you know, they are putting in a lot of pellets. So just bear that in mind. If you go on my river now, I know they use a lot of F1. They use a lot of F1 ground bait, and they might just mix it with some brown crumb, and then they might put a little bit of like sort of roachy mix in it, a bit of hemp, you know, crushed hemp. But a lot of anglers are using F1 ground bait on rivers, whether that's dark because the water's clear or just natural if the water's got some color in it. But yeah, that's, you know, and then if I was going bream fishing, that would probably be my go-to mix, to be honest. It'd probably be F1 and maybe even something like bream feeder, just to give it a little bit of weight to it, because F1 is quite, it's quite a light ground bait. So if the river's got a bit of flow, mix something in like that. I think we spoke about that last time, like that bream feeder. If you mix that with dark F1, that would take that yellow color out of it as well. If the water was dirty going through a bit, don't worry about it. You know what I mean? Just mix that in with your F1. Perfect. If I was going on a river and I was like targeting chub and roach, you know, maybe you're going to a venue which in a lot of bream in it, then I'd just put something like natural. We got something called, got some here actually. A little bit of left in the bag. That's a fantastic mix. We produced that last year. Done a lot of work. It's called Black Roach. Tons of hemp in it. Lots of little particles of hemp and some bigger parts of it. And I normally mix that with like So Natural Lake. You mix them two together on the feeder. Absolutely perfect. Mm-hmm. But you can mix them two together. If you want to mix your F1 with that, it just depends on what river you're going on. It's the bream thing for me. If there's a lot of bream about, probably Joe, you go on the Trent, you probably use F1.
Yeah, if it's like on the tidal stretches, you tend to know where the bream are, don't you? Or within reason, if you're fishing out and out for bream. And I actually, a tip Wayne Bartholomew told me, is like, if you are fishing, going to go down that route, don't be frightened to be aggressive. So on the Trent, for example, it's way more barbel anglers than it ever will match anglers. So he crushes up halibut pellets or uses our like hemp and halley crush, something like that. Yeah. So I'll happily use that. But you do catch a lot of normal ground bait. So
yeah, you've got to mix and match, I think. It's like my river. I know when they're targeting bream, they do go down the fish meal road and they do mix a little bit of normal brown crumb with it. That seems to be a real good mix on my river. Mm. But if you're targeting, like Joe just said, if you go on the Trent, I know they put a lot of halley. I ain't got any of that here, I don't think. Or have I?
But yeah, they really do like that halibut.
I actually give my last bag, this is the true story, I give my last bag to Ian Pauly. Then he went on the Trent, not last year, the year before in the Division One National, and he won the National. He did draw really well. He drew by the weir, and I think he had like something like 90 pounds of barbel and chub.
Yeah, it was a ridiculous day's fishing, wasn't it?
Yeah, and I actually give him my last bag of Halley Crush.
Brilliant.
Yeah, so that was, yeah, but that's the sort of things. But deep, slow rivers, I think F1, Bran Crumb, maybe put some sort of black roach in it if you want to just target a bit of both. And like probably like Joe said, if you're going on more like the Trent, I know they do use a lot of Halley sort of crushed halibut pellet because they a lot of barbel anglers, and it's a quicker river, Joe, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just more aggressive, isn't it, the Trent? It's so fast.
My river, a lot of my river is slow, deep. You can fish like light ground baits, where on the Trent, it's powerful, and I think probably a sort of like a hallow, put some halibut, crushed halibut mix in with it.
Yeah. So just to finish his question off, when would you use a maggot feeder?
Well, you'd always have it with you, even on the Trent in the summer. You know, you can go there and fish with ground bait. Some days the fish want ground bait. Some days maggot feeder outscores that, no problem at all. It's something you've just got an experiment with. You know, sometimes you can fish ground bait at the, you know, out in front of you, and then sometimes chuck a maggot feeder down your peg. If the fishing gets a bit worse and they're not coming to the ground bait, they're backed off, chuck a maggot feeder downstream from your ground bait. If them fish are just hanging off, sometimes chucking a maggot feeder down your peg can just get you them odd extra fish. But normally maggot feeder comes in it's an hard question. It's a good question, but it's an hard one to answer because I can't really sort of put a thing when you fish a maggot feeder. It's always there, and it just depends on what happens with your fishing. You know, I would start on ground bait because ground bait seems to be the in thing, and it definitely catches you bream, hybrids, everything that swims really. But if it's one of them days where they're a bit tricky, they're not feeding very well, then the maggot feeder can definitely score.
The brilliant thing with the maggot feeder as well, Des, it's instant, isn't it? So you'll know within a few casts. Yeah. If it's going to be a maggot feeder sort of timing your match, quick. You catch quick, yeah. Don't you?
And the thing is with maggot feeder, I think it limits you to what you're fishing. A maggot feeder is like you put maggots on the hook. Mm. I know some people put like crushed hemp through the maggot feeder. But for me, with ground bait feeder, you can put big worms on, double caster, double maggot, everything, you know. And I think it gives you, if you want to select a bigger fish, it's nice because you can sit there with a whole worm on and think, oh, I don't want to catch a little roach. I want to sit there and try and catch a bream or a big chub. And that's what's so nice about a ground bait feeder over a maggot feeder. Just depends on the venues, really.
Definitely, definitely. Right. Two elastic questions in a row here. Mark Shaw wants to know, what elastic would you recommend for fishing Belinge short, 2+2-ish, and margins?
I don't mess about it, Belinge. There's one thing that he would probably know. Was it Mark in it?
Mark
name?
Shaw, yeah.
Yeah, I think he probably, if he's been there, you know, they are probably one of the wildest, hardest fighting fish. I mean, you do get your air. That's why I don't have much air left. Probably fishing Belinge for near on 20 years. You will come, and they are a nightmare. They just do not want to come in. I mean, normally I try and fish short and down the edge. I normally fish 14 jaw hollow because of the wear and tear on your gear. You know, you catch 200 pound at Belinge, you know you've caught 200 pound. I mean, I went there. I actually had a great day back in October, and I caught 200. I think I can't remember what weight I had now. I drew peg one, and I actually caught some fish on paste, which is unusual for me, but really? I fish paste. Yeah, and I had a good run on it in the last sort of hour and a half. And yeah, I had to fish 14 hollow. But the minimum I'd fish there would be a 12, a minimum.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, I've always said to people, if you can fish a bit, when you're fishing long, 14 half, 13, 14 half, 16 meters, the heavier elastic you use, you do feel that at long distance on the pole. So I try and fish like a 11 or a 12 long, but 14 short and down the edge. For the simple fact is, it's wear and tear and getting the fish out. They do wreck elastic at Belinge, proper. You just can't get them up. Nice. And you've just got to take your time, because if you get your air off with them, it's pointless. It makes it worse.
I've broke top kits there before, trying to get my air off with them, like chasing, snap.
Yeah, they are an absolute nightmare. They go around with their tails out of the water like that, and you think, come on, come on. But just take your time, use something like a 14, and you'll be fine.
Nice. Joseph Farley wants to know, now this is quite a hard one to answer this, but we'll do our best. What three hollow elastics will cover you for 100% of your fishing? Now, you can't possibly do that, but I think if you could pick three out to cover him for most of his fishing,
Yeah, I mean, obviously, I don't know if he's fishing for sewer fish.
I'd suggest not. Commercials, no. I reckon.
If he's commercial, then you go 10, I'd go 10, 12, 14.
Yeah.
That would be it. In Jura, because I like Jura hollows. I do fish a bit of 11, the old hollow. But normally I fish 10, 12, and 14, and that will cover you. You know, 14, like I just said with the previous question, if you're going somewhere and it's proper fishing, there's a, you know, you're trying to catch big, either lots and lots of fish, or you're trying to catch big fish, simple for the wear and tear. 12 is what I would say. If I drew a peg, I've got a wasp in me garage now. If I drew like a tough area at Belinji and I knew it was going to be rock hard and there is some carassio there, I'd probably fish like a 12, even short, because I want to try and get everything out. If I drew a good peg, so if 12 is a nice elastic for that, you know, I fish a 12 at Todborough a lot of the time because it's just nice. You know, you can get a 3 or 4 pound carp on it, but you can also catch one 15, 16 pound. And then the 10 is just one of them elastics. You can catch decent sized bream, F1s, odd carp. You can get anything out on 10, but obviously if you catch a big carp on 10, it does come out a lot further. So 10, 12 and 14 would cover you for 85% of your fishing, if not 90% of your fishing on commercials.
Yeah, I'd go with that.
Yeah.
I think that's a nice little range. This is an odd one. David Boo wants to know, when fishing in the rain, does the noise from catapulting pellets lose its effectiveness?
Yeah, I think it does. I think it makes a big difference. I remember I've been on loads of matches in the past and I'm like fishing shallow and you see a big black cloud come over and you're like, no. I don't believe it.
It's the worst, isn't it?
And it ruins it, Joe. Yeah. I bet you've had it.
Oh, loads of times.
Even if it's just that little bit, it's not too bad if it's like that fine stuff that don't seem to matter. But as soon as it starts to react, you know, starts tapping on the water, for me, I've had matches ruined on because of the rain. Whether that makes them swim off because they don't want to be on it, whether it spooks them, I don't know, but it definitely makes a difference, 100%, especially when you're fishing shallow.
Yeah, 100%. I agree with that. I don't know if it's so much as a noise as the air pressure change, but there's something goes on, isn't there?
Something goes on. They don't like it. I've been kicking myself because it's raining. Because it's, you know, like you just sort of primed the line up for 2 hours, 3 hours. You just started getting a few bites shallow and it rains and it ruins it. And it's not a coincidence. It does ruin it.
Yeah.
And sometimes it don't never come back. Once you've had a shower, I think the fish, wherever they go down, it, like I said, pressure changes. It definitely don't like it.
I always remember a few years ago, Des, you fishing the match. You remember the pole fishing masters at Tunnel Barn? And I was filming it that year, and it chucked it down. It was rubbish before it. It chucked it down, and then it fished its head off after it. And that's
I'll tell you what happened that day. I remember the match. I was on about 29 on high, I reckon, around there when I was back in that bed. And I was catching on slop.
Yeah, jigger, I seem to remember.
Jigger. Well, this is what happened. Luckily, I had the jigger. I had two jiggers set up. I had one set up for like 18 inches deep. And I had one set up for like 3 foot. And then we were fishing away. I was catching all right. It wasn't great, but I was catching okay. And then this massive storm came over, and I'm like, I can't believe it. I was doing well, you know, for me, I could see most of my section, and I knew what was going to happen. And we had this big storm, hailstones and all sorts, and it ruined it. And I remember, I thought, I'll just try a bit deeper. And it was quite deep, right? That peg's like 7 foot deep, isn't it? 8 foot deep.
Yeah, definitely.
And I picked me deeper jigger up, and I dropped in, and I caught them 2.5 foot deep, chucking slop in.
Amazing, isn't it?
No one else could catch. Everybody's still flicking their rigs over and all that. And I must have caught 20 or 30. They weren't that big. And I think that's what a lot of times happens. That storm pushes them down. and they're sort of mid-water and they won't go down, they won't come up. So, yeah, you remember that, yeah. You know.
Good session, that.
Yeah.
Robert Warwick says he watched your box setup video and he says, very good. He has an on-box with square legs. Can he use the same adapters, which he can't he?
Yes, you've got to find the same...
square adapters, don't you?
You can get the inserts. So as long as you've got... I think the off-box 36 attachments, this is what I use on that setup. If you buy... well, I'll show you now. I have got...
so obviously all our boxes used to be square legs, didn't they?
I'm not going to post them. But you've got all that is inserts from over about 20... well, I don't know when we've done the off-box stuff. I've got friends, family. It's like, oh, you got one of them inserts? So if I haven't, then I don't know where they've gone. But if you get the right insert, like that, that's the off-box 36 insert, and that goes straight on your... there's different ones, isn't there?
Yeah, he says the on-box 3D, which I think is that one with the rounded edge. I could be wrong, but...
not sure, but they will. The inserts mostly come with the attachments. So if you buy like that, that's a classic example. That's one of the new side tray support arms. And you see, when you buy the arm, you get all your different inserts ready to go. So there'll be an insert on there for your box, one of them.
Nice.
So yeah, you can get the inserts. That's an off-box 36 attachment, obviously, with inserts already in. But if you get that, normally when you, well, you do get most of the attachments you buy, you get the option of, they all come with it. Yeah. So there's lots of options for every different, you know, different box setups and different legs.
So, in short, it is possible. You just need to get some of the little...
the right inserts. Unfortunately, I'm not going to send these.
They're like your old friends, then?
That's my old friends. I don't use them anymore, so I just use the off-box 36 ones.
Chris K says, thanks for the videos. They're brilliant. Would you ever fish a hair rig on the pole? And if so, under what circumstances?
Hair rig on the pole? Mm. Yeah, a lot. Shallow and on the deck. Lots of hard pellet fishing. For me personally, when I'm fishing on the pole, on the deck or shallow with pellets, most of the time I hair rig. Sometimes I like fishing just putting the band on, like old school, if you like, for fishing short. But when I'm fishing long, I hair rig with hard pellets all the time. I'm not one of these people that hair rig meat and corn on the pole. I just prefer hooking it. The only time I've really ever done that, hair rig on the pole, is I'm fishing up against like an island, really long, like 16 meters plus, and I'm getting loads of bites, and I can't hook them. I can't hook the fish. I've been, I remember a situation at Belinge years ago, and I was fishing just a normal hook. I was fishing 18 and a half meters. That was before Whiteacres brought a pole limit on. And it's one of them occasions where I just basically put one of my method feeder hook links on with a rapid stop on. Because I was just missing bites, and it was driving me up. You know, coming back 18 meters was not good. And then I hair rigged. I went over, and literally, I wouldn't come back unless I hooked a fish. Mm. But normally, it's just definitely hard pellet. Lots of hard pellet fishing. Whether you're fishing shallow on the deck, I hair rig with an eye hook. And that's it, really. I don't normally air rig anything else. Normally, I just hook it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's so that. When you say banded pellets, just to clear that up for this chap, you actually hair rig your pellets by putting a hair rig band, yeah?
Yeah, I got my bands. Yeah, got my bands done. Actually, that's me three inch hook links. Let's get that out of the way a minute. Where are we? I think that's them. Yeah, those are my GPMs. And then obviously these ones, I've already got the bands on. You can see that.
Yep.
So that's sort of me all general purpose air rigging. What, you know, anywhere I go for air rigging pellets.
Nice.
There's my GPM 6 inches already done.
Nice.
At the moment, we only do pre-tied spade end GPMs. but eventually we will be doing pre-tied bands as well, so I won't even have to do them.
Yeah, so nice one. Martin Ellis says, when fishing large reservoirs, he uses Paul for an example, have you found it worth using a large baiting feeder to kick off a session before using a window or other feeder over the top?
No. Porth's a funny place. If anything, I'd literally just start fishing. I find you could go there and do it, but I have actually done that, but I've never had that much success. For me, and you'll find that with a lot of venues, like Tamar, when I walked around with like Tamar last year in the Feeder Masters competition, the final, it was about casting regularly. It was about not sitting there waiting for a bite. It was making a column of bait. The fish are in that column of bait, and it was about casting really like every 2 or 3 minutes. And Porth, you know, bear in mind, Porth doesn't get fish that much. He gets fish by carp anglers. And there's a lot of venues like that. I mean, there is venues you can go and put a lot of bait in. You know, Shearwater, for example, even in the winter, you can go there and put quite a lot of bait in at the start. But you're normally waiting for big fish. You're not trying to catch these sort of fish. And at Porth, it's about catching these. Mm. I mean, see, if the big ones rock up, that's like a major bonus. But whether you're fishing the pole or the feeder on a lot of reservoirs, it's about feeding regularly, you know, making a cloud, keeping the fish in your peg. If you don't, keep casting regularly, they just seem to swim away. No matter how much bait you put on the bottom, they're gone. I mean, I went to that Lag Deg Fed in last year's fish tank. It was fantastic. Massive reservoir, you know, huge. Doesn't get fish that much. The worst thing you can do, it doesn't matter how much bait, you can go there with 25 litres of ground bait, right? And they will not settle on the bottom. They will not settle. You've got to keep casting. Mm. And all of a sudden, they go down, they have a bit of a munch, and then you've lost them again. And the worst thing, it's like literally, you can use a stopwatch. If you don't get a bite after 3 minutes, you come back in and cast out. It's hard work, but no, Porth in that, and places, a lot of places now, is not about putting loads of bait in. It's about casting regularly. That's what I see anyway.
Yeah, because I've had it, I fished that Hollowell Reservoir near me, and granted, it's not in matches, but you're fishing, you know, pleasure fishing, and you can catch 30 bream in a day that are common. And you couldn't possibly hold them with an amount of bait anyway. No. Because what happens there, they clear you out and they bugger off. So I find it best to actually use one of those feeders as an impact. Like exactly what you say, chuck it in every now and again, pull them to the bottom, catch your fish, and then do it again an hour later or something like that. So that's worth
it. Everywhere is different, isn't it, with that? That's what makes it really interesting. But Porth is, to me, even when you hear people about catching weights on the method at Porth, they ain't feeding nothing.
No.
You think they're chucking in like 20, 30 foot of water. They ain't, you know, a lot of people, you know, you ask people, you say to people, how have you caught? Well, basically, I was struggling on the pole. I couldn't catch on a normal feeder. I lobbed the method out. It went straight round. I'm like, well, hang on. There's no bait there. I've gone there and like catapulted like 15 balls of micros and ground bait in. And I actually got on it and ain't caught nothing. And I think, well, actually, what I should have done was just chuck the method out. Because I've not gone on it straight away, that probably doesn't help. So they might have come in, mopped up and gone. Mm. It's ever so strange. It's a strange scenario. But every venue is slightly different. But there's not many venues now, apart from like Shearwater, where you can, and you can overdo it. That's the worst thing you can do, is overdo it. I remember Bartlett, you know, we both know Mark Bartlett. He fishes for like the carp specimen team. And we went there. He's like, because we always have a bit of a chat before we go. He's like, I'm going to fill it in. And I'm like, yeah, I think that'll work. And I'm like, and I don't know, because I'm thinking, you know, he's really good at casting spots and stuff. Like, he's ridiculous. And he put like 3 pints of maggots in, some ground bait and micros, and he caught sod all. And it, do you know what I mean? But he did actually get away with it because he caught a few big carp. But you can also overdo it, because around him, he caught bream. And then bream, I don't know whether there was too much bait there and he couldn't catch the fish. I think sometimes that happens. Mm. You know, they're all there and they're all picking, choosing what they're picking up. And if you put too much in, you give them too much, and they're quite happy just picking them up, picking all that other, you know, them freebies up. We know how crafty sometimes they are. So there's a little bit of that to, a little bit of that involved as well. Definitely. Don't overdo it.
I had a match last year as well. You was on the match at Patsall Park.
And yeah.
all the chat was, you got to fill it in, fill it in, fill it in. I drew the deeps. I filled it in proper. Two lines, filled it in. And I just blew my peg straight away. Yeah. Jamie Harrison was next to me. Fished a tiny little feeder all day. Never put any bait in. Just kept plopping it in. He caught 20 pound of fish. And I was just like...
Do you think there was fish in your peg and you just couldn't catch?
Yeah, because I caught some bream early. Yeah. But yeah. It was 20 odd foot deep. And it was stupid, really, in hindsight. But
too much going on. But that's why we go fishing, isn't it? That's why we go fishing. Because every day you draw your own thing. Oh, you know, you've put too much in. Or I should have filled it in. You know. But yeah, places like Porth, like going back to Porth, it's amazing that you can just... like literally just start fishing. The worst thing you could do is put a pile of bait in. Strange on a big venue like that, you think you'd want to just pile it in. I think if you piled it in and come back the next day, I think that's when it can be brilliant.
Yeah,
a lot of venues you go to, I'll bring venues, especially if you're on like a two-day festival and someone says, oh yeah, I absolutely bombed the bait in, I ain't caught nothing. You're going there thinking, oh, yeah. Because all them fish would have probably gone over that overnight. And you can just start fishing and catch straight away. So you've got to be careful about not, you know, overdoing it, more so in underdoing it.
Definitely. Right. Moving on then. So Jamie Jambon Wayne, he's had loads of questions.
He has. He's Wayne. The Jambon. He's the Jambon. Isn't he? That reminds me of a biscuit or a...
Jammy Dodger.
Yeah. Jambonny.
He says he's got a response pole, an M70, which he loves.
Yeah.
He says, but the pre-fitted blue bushes in the power kits seem a bit narrow for the larger diameter hollows. What do you think? How big could he realistically go without having any trouble?
Well, he must be fishing serious elastics, because I've got 16 hollows running through my blue tops. You know, as long as it's coming out and working, don't worry about it. I mean, if he wanted to, he could cut them back. I know the actual top kits that come with the response carp, they got red internals. They're slightly bigger again. And I think I'm not sure what the name of them is. I think.
I've chopped my power kits back a little bit.
I've got everything there.
Look at that, straight on it.
There you go. That's that's the tops you get with a response carp, which are power tops. But they've got like a gold, you can see that. Can you see the gold?
Yep.
On there? And that's a 16 hollow. I mean, if you start using anything above that, I don't know what you'd be towing. You'd be working for the RAC, towing cars about. But that comes through there. You can see that. That's easy. But I've got 16 hollow running. I don't carry that many 16 top kits with me anyway. They're just for like special occasions. but that comes out of there absolutely perfect. And you know, as long as it comes out like that, that's dry, obviously, it's not been used. If it comes out like that, it is working all right, don't worry. But then normally them blue internals on a carp top take a 14 or 16 hollow perfectly.
Yeah.
All right. Nice, but then you can get the red internals. If you wanted to, you could cut your top kits back a little bit, because the red internal is a little bit bigger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nice. Okay. Horace Potter wants to know, on the videos, he keeps spotting... Ooh, Horace
Harry Potter?
Harry Potter. He says, Potter. Every time he watches this video, there's a load of bottles of slip behind you.
Yeah.
Do you actually use it? He says he's never seen anybody actually use elastic lube.
What, this stuff?
Yeah.
Use it all the time.
Yeah.
Well, this is how things work. That's my sample bottle I had. Don't know. There's a code on that, which I've got to go careful. That's my sample bottle that I used, which I was messing about with. I got it from Preston. And then they obviously sent me a few. There's a couple of bottles there, which are brand new. There's a bottle there, which is actually empty.
It goes a long way, doesn't it, Des?
Yeah. Well, I've kept that. I think we spoke about this the other time. If you... Not being funny, a bottle like that, and that's a 250ml bottle, that will last you a long time. A season, easily, I would say. And it lasts me a season. I go fishing more, you know, more than most. I use it all, you know, on my slip elastics, which is like, if you look on the picture, you got like anywhere what they call the original slip, I use it every single time. It makes it work unbelievable. Loads of people said to me, it's how it's transformed their elastics. Yeah. Hundreds of people. People use it all the time. But yeah, that's just, I got my bottle. Where is it?
I'll take my Preston hat off for a minute, but that is the best lube on the market.
It is ever. There's my mile. That's my bottle that I've just taken out the out my carry-all, covered in mud and junk.
He must use it anyway, because he says if he doesn't want it, can he have it?
No.
Very, very charitable today, mate.
I am very charitable. no, that's my little stash that I got. Probably got it from Dave Lloyd. So thanks, Dave, for sorting me them few bottles out when I last come out to the factory. Yeah. Because when I go to the World Championships, obviously I take a few with me, because there's other anglers that probably want some as well. So I always take a few bottles with me, you know.
Good gear.
Not mention no names.
Phil O'Connell wants to say, how often do you change your elastic? Do you look for signs of breakage and change, or do you do it every few months, or how do you do it?
It's about, basically, what I do, well, I'm not going to lie, I mean, that's like a 9 hollow in that top kit. What I'll do is, now and again, I mean, if I've had a real good day's fishing on any elastic, whether that's a 6, right up to a 14 hollow or 16, if I've used a 1 top kit all day, As I'm packing up, I'll keep that top kit to one side and I'll do it straight away. I'll check it and I might just tie it. And what I do normally is do that on my lip. If it's a little bit rough, normally they're, you know, when they're brand new, you've got that and it's all soft, nice, so it's like brand new. If that gets really rough, then you might have to you don't have to sometimes change the whole lot. You might just take the first couple of inches off and re-tie your Dacron back on. That's what I do as much as I can. But obviously, when it starts going rough, like a foot or so down, you sort of think, oh, God, that's sort of nearly gone. That's the time to change it, you know, to change a whole lot. But if you can, like I said, change, like, you know, take 2 or 3 inches off and put your Dacron back on. That's what's so nice about hollows, is you can adjust, like, take 2 or 3 inches off. It doesn't really make a huge difference on the tension, where like the older solid elastics, if you take 4 or 5 inches off, it can make quite a lot of difference, especially on lighter elastics. Mm. But that's what I do. Run your lip or your finger along. The rougher it gets, then you've got to think about changing it. But if you like I said, if you've had a real good day's fishing and you're a bit worried about where the Dacron goes on, take 2 inches off, retie it. As long as it's not too rough and it feels like it's going to go, just do that.
Nice one. So just keep an eye on it, essentially.
Keep your eye on it. Always check it.
Yep. Nice one.
Check it after you fish sometimes. Like I said, if you've been sacking up all day, do them before you put them back in your top kits, back in your holder, if you just want to redo your Dacron.
Yeah. Okay. Damon Townsend wants to know, hi, Joe and Des. This is a question for both of us. Wouldn't you like to be drawn next to, and why? And if you see an angler doing something wrong on the next peg, would you tell them, or would you wait till the end of the match? I'd definitely wait till the end of the match.
Well, if he's chucking his feeder in my peg, I'd probably tell him, like, as we're going.
Yeah. I ain't helping nobody out in the match, mate.
Sometimes I do. Sometimes I'll just say, have you tried a little bit shallower? But that's when I'm probably about £80 in front of him, then. To be perfectly honest. If it's close, then you wouldn't... You know, in a match, you wouldn't be in your right mind, would you?
No. I ain't doing it.
No. It'd be after the match. It's like I said to people, look, the most important thing is to you to go up to people after a match, not during the match, or before the match, and say, look, you know, can I look at your rigs? And any decent angler out there will say, yeah, you know, carry on. If they don't, then don't talk to them again.
I don't think it's right in a match, though.
In a match situation, obviously you're going there, you're competitive and you're trying to do as best you can from, you know, from the peg that you've got, but go up afterwards. That's what I used to do when I used to fish rivers all the time. I used to go up, just walk, get off my box, go for a little walk after the match, waiting for the scales, and have a look at people's rig, and you think, oh, that's quite interesting, that's the sort of thing that you learn more doing that than a lot of things.
Definitely.
As for the other part of it, who would you not want to be next door to?
Yeah, who would you not want to be next door more to?
Alan Scawthorne, really. Just a bit miserable.
I knew that was coming.
And he's a damn good angler. No. I don't know, really. I'm not that fussed. You know, there's lots of good anglers. There's loads, isn't there? So many good anglers. And if you're next door to them, you just got to try and beat them.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. You know, yeah, there is more pressure on you, I suppose, because you want to be the one that walks off the bank and says, oh, actually, I beat so-and-so today. Yeah, you know. And they want to do the same to you. So there's no one, really. As long as I can have a chat with them.
Yeah. Which I do. I like a chat on the bank, me.
I love that chat. There is some of them that hate it. They can't concentrate.
Yeah.
John Harvey. John Arthur. He's one that he can't handle it. He can't handle. I've been next to him a couple of times. And I've tried to have a conversation. Not a conversation, but, you know, about what weight you've got and, you know, and all that. And then, nah. No.
There ain't no banter there, is there?
No, forget it. Finished. So, yeah.
Who wouldn't I want to draw next to? I don't think I've drawn next to you a few times, actually. But I probably wouldn't want to get drawn next to you, to be fair. Look at this, actually.
Go on.
This, look at that, look. That's from 2007.
Jesus. Right?
And look, I was only young. And I talk about a Maver Pairs match I drew next to you. And I drew the MPEG on the grass bank, and I think I won the match, and you were second.
Yeah, that was when the MPEG started going it, Lord. Yeah.
It was all F1 shallow, that was.
Yeah.
Back when there was F1s in there.
Was that where I was probably pairing with Steve Mayo back then?
Yeah, you would have been, yeah. You'd won it the day before. I think it was the pole one the next day.
Yeah, I've got the cat. I'm going to go at me now. Come on, Josh. Shut up.
Yeah, but I don't really want to draw next to you, to be honest.
No,
we'd have a giggle, but you'd just bash me up. So.
Yeah, I don't really want to. I don't really think about who I don't want to draw. It's just as long as you can have a chat with them and enjoy the day, that's the most thing.
Yeah, nice. This is a good question, actually. Pete Fairfax says, "How come we've got all these fantastic ground baits that Sonia Baits and other companies develop? Yeah, all top anglers seem to mix two and three types together. Why is that?"
Yeah, that's a good question. It's like I said about the river question I answered earlier. Sometimes it's about making it heavy, because some ground baits, like F1, for example, is a light ground bait. It's a lot of crushed expander pellet. So it makes it light. And sometimes it's too light. It's too light for what you're trying to do. And like when you mix other like natural ground baits, if you go for natural ground baits, like the ones that Sonia do, like the... like I said about this earlier, you know, there's black roach. It's got tons of hemp in it. So some crumb, got loads of coriander. And sometimes you don't want to use that on its own. You want to mix something else with it. You want a bit of fish meal with it. If you go on the river and think, well, just give myself a chance of, you know, there is a couple of bream about. And that's why people mix stuff together. I do. I mix like Thatcher's and Match Method mix together. Because I just like that. Match Method mix is there's a few particles in it, and Thatcher's is goes through a different milling process. It goes through the finest milling process that some new baits do. So when you're going through like the winter mode, when the fish aren't really feeding that heavily, I think just want to take the feed content out of it. So it makes a cloud, but the fish are like hunting for nothing really. So that's what goes through my mind. That's what goes through a lot of anglers' minds. It's just one of them really. But I totally get it. You know, I totally get what, you know, it can be quite confusing sometimes. But it's more about what content you're trying to put in your ground bait. If you want to change the consistency of it, if you don't want it too fluffy and light, you want some in between, you might have to mix two ground baits together. Like, you know, if it's like the edge mix, you know, that is like, takes loads of water. It's heavy. It's claggy. You can make it claggy, you know what I mean? And sometimes you want that mixed together with like a bit of something else so it don't go too claggy. So it's down to personal preference really.
It's worth saying as well that by all means use them straight, just one mix is absolutely fine, isn't it?
Yeah, of course it is. But sometimes I just think you just want to change that slightly for the conditions that you're fishing in and what you're trying to fish for. I think a lot of it comes down to silverfish ground baits. When they're trying to catch bream on commercial, sometimes, you know, viaduct, for example, you know, you want to put some natural, when it's really cold, you want to put natural ground bait in with fish meal, because the fishing's just not good enough to take a full-blown fish meal ground bait. But you want that fish meal in it. That's where it gets a little bit sort of confusing for people. They're like, well, why are you putting that natural ground bait in? Because I want to be catching these little skimmers and little roach. You know, I'm not going there. I'm not on a peg where I can catch 30 pound of bream. I'm trying to catch these. You know, and sometimes that depends where you actually sit on the day. If you draw terrible on one of the lakes, you know, an area where, you know, they're not going to catch 20 pound of silvers. You might be fishing for 10 pound of roach. They won't come over fish meal. So if you want to think, oh, I'm going to put 70% natural ground bait into 30% fish meal. And that's why you mix your two ground baits together.
Yeah, to give you the best. Good answer.
What a difficult question to answer, but a lot of it comes into knowing the venue, what you're fishing for, and where you've drawn, where you're sitting, you know?
Good answer. Well done. This continues the ground bait theme. It's Carl Reynolds. He says, this is regarding Thatcher's. He says, obviously there's original and now there's a dark. Would you ever mix the two together?
Yeah. Yeah, if you just want to tone that natural off just a bit, which sometimes I have done, you know, just tone it off a little bit because it is quite light. I've got some flashes here.
No fatches.
No, I have got fatches here, but I don't know where it is. Oh, I have. Here we go. There's the natural. So there's your natural. It's quite a light round bit. You can probably see that in the light.
Yeah, just about. It's light brown, isn't it?
Quite light, which I, you know, and I might just put, I think the last time, it's a bit like, I think the last time I went fishing, actually, I used like a bag of Thatcher's and quarter of a bag of dark Thatcher's or quarter of a bag of F1 dark just to tone it off a little bit. You know, so I want it light, but I don't want it black either. I don't want it dark, you know. So yeah, I do mix them together, but not normally. Normally like a bag of natural to a quarter of a bag of dark.
Yeah.
Just to tone it off a little bit.
Nice. Dave Lee says, backshot seems to be the big thing in pole rigs these days. He says, but I've never seen you use one in your videos.
No, I get asked a lot about that. It's something that I've never, ever... You see, it's weird. In the south, you don't see many anglers use it. Where if you go to sort of north, like Lindome, places like that, I would say you see a lot of anglers use backshot. For me, I've never tried it really. I've just fished the way I fish. I don't need to change. I think my presentation's okay. It's all right.
It's all right, isn't it?
Right. I don't need to change. If I want to, if the conditions are bad and it's towing, I normally just drop my pole tip under the water a little bit. So it's a sort of same principle. I know you're not holding your pole tip over your float with a backshot, is what you can. But no, just not one of them things for me. It's as simple as that. There's no other way around it, really. Perhaps in time I'll start messing around with it, playing around with it. But at the moment, I just think it's not for me.
Yeah.
It's something I don't want on my rig, basically. And I know a lot of people will say completely opposite, but that's fishing. You know, that's like any sport. People like certain ways, and if you want a backshot on, I ain't got a problem with that. Mm. But for me, at the moment, no. It's something that I don't even think about. I get asked loads, why don't you use a backshot? And I'm like, I answer the same thing every time. It feels for me like I don't need to do it. So I'm not doing it at the moment.
Yeah. Fair enough. Right. There's loads of it. Right. Tim Joyce. Hi, Tim. I know Tim. He says, right, if KKMs are your go-to method feeder hook, what is the point of MCMs? Why do we even have MCMs? I thought MCM was a dedicated method hook.
It is, but it's a lot stronger. And it's a circle hook. there's a lot of anglers out there, like with any sort of hook, they love certain shapes of hooks and the circle. I've actually got some chucked over here. Look. You know, that's your circle hook. You see it on the packaging there. You know, when we went to Bollington's filming, this sort of venue where...
It's perfect for there, isn't it?
If it was, like, warmer and the fish were having a go, you can fish 019, 021 power line hook links. You need a hook that's going to, you know, be able to stand that grief and that power of them fish. So, yeah, the KKM is my go-to hook for 90-odd% of my fishing. But that is a powerhouse. Them circle hooks, you can, you know, you'd have to, I don't know how you bend one out, to be honest, unless you caught in a piece of wood. So that hook is a different class. It's a different gauge. It's stronger. It's a different shape. It's not the hook that I use on a lot of my fishing because I don't, there is occasions when I go to Bollington's and that, but not all the time. But there's an awful lot of people that love that style of hook because of the strength and obviously the line that you can put through the eye. It's sort of 8 or 10 pound hook lengths, which is what you want when you're going to Bollington's and you're drawing a lot of fish there. That's got to take a lot of grief. Where a KKM, I think you'd be like, hang on. You know, if I was there at Bollington's catching loads of fish and I started on a KKM and it kept going round, I'd be thinking, what, I'm going to put one of them on. No different to fishing the pole, is it? You'd have different gauge hooks with you. It's like if I was going to go Bollingi, for example, and I was using a GPM and the fishing was that good, I'm like, whoa, hang on. I need to get an XSH out here. That's how my brain would work. Mm. I'd go there with that nice sort of setup. Well, I know I can get everything out, but all of a sudden things change. You're like, well, hang on, I need to step this up here. You know, I'm on a load of fish, they're feeding. Same example, different gauge, heavier line, and that's what they're there for. It's as simple as that.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of these sort of crossover venues now, Barston, Bollington, great examples, Larford, where you do need a heavy hook, and the MCM's perfect, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely perfect. If Bollington's is exactly the same. If you were going there and they just switched on, you're catching all these great big things, you'd have one of them with you. Oh, hang on. I'll have that KKM off and just try, oh, hello. And then as soon as you open it, it's like that, isn't it? Oh, yes. You know, you're fishing 019, 021 up length, where before you were fishing 017, 015 with a big 15-pounder on, you'd be like, oh, hang on, got to go a bit careful here. With one of them on, it's like, there ain't no need to go careful here. You know, I mean, that's true. That's the truth of it, isn't it? That's why we produce different gauges of hooks to cover all the, you know, situations.
Right, here's one. This is quite a good one. John Wharton says he's newly filled his spool to the brim, but when he started fishing, it's as if the line freely coils off the spool, causing problems. Any remedies?
I don't know what pound line you've got on. I've got some spools here. It's getting on my nerves, that piece of metal now. That's a spool. That's a 420 Centris with 8 pound sinking feeder mono on. Let me see if I can do a little demonstration. I haven't got my little ruler.
Oh, no.
Oh, come on. I need something straight. There he is. So if I hold that on there, that's probably the best. Do you want
me? Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, that's fine.
See that? Yep. So the line, that's 8 pound sinking feeder mono. And you can see that your line, what's his name, John?
Yeah.
John, your line's probably, you've got a little bit too much line on, I would say. That for me is about right. I could probably get a tad more on there if I wanted to. But you can see that it's not, you don't want it coming right over this part of the spool. Down here is not too bad. What I would say, Joe, would you say that was like probably, I could probably get another 15-20 meters on there.
It looks pretty good to me.
To be honest, that would be the maximum. I would say you might have one, your spool might be too small. If you're fishing with like if you're fishing with 8 pound line, you've got it on a real small spool. I mean, that's a 320 spool. Sometimes if you fish a small spool with heavy line, you can get that springiness more because it's tightly banged. When you fish with a bigger spool, like I said, a 420, which I think's anything to do with feeder fishing, normal feeder fishing, a 420 is the perfect size. You can get 8 pound on that. So you've got to take that into consideration. Have a look at your spool size, but don't overfill it. You know, 100 metres of line on a spool is ample.
Yeah.
You know, unless you hook jewels and it's going to take you off like 80, 90 metres, which is probably unlikely. But yeah, look at your spool size. I mean, on a 320 size reel, 300, 3000 size reel, I would say a maximum of 6 pound because you will get that springiness which will come off.
Yeah. It's definitely just an overfill problem, I'd say that.
Take it off. Take a little bit off. And I'm sure that will solve the problem straight away.
Yeah. It's the same with braid, isn't it, Des? I've had it so many times when you fill a new reel up and you're like, oh, that's beautiful, only to chuck out and loads of line comes off and you end up in a braid.
There's some braid there. It's actually probably a bit less.
Yeah, I'm going to say a bit less of a braid, I'd say.
A bit less on braid.
Perfect.
We'll get problems. Go under. I know loads of people say, oh, fill your spool up because it casts much, much better. That's all right with finer lines, but once you start using 6 or 8 pound, 10 pound main lines, just go very, very careful.
Yeah. Good tip there. There's a good tip. Right, let's find the next one because there's loads again. Right, Joe Sawyer says, big fan of the ICS system. Question is, can you use a cube with a long stem? Does it affect presentation?
Not really. No. I think it just looks a little bit out of place because you've got a long stem with a little cube at the bottom. But presentation wise, no. I mean, I normally use a normal stem which will take a small feeder and a large feeder because I can go between the two, obviously. And if I want to put a cube on, I can. I'm not going to take the stem off and put a little stem on. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the ICS. Obviously, the ICM is a little bit neater for that. Smaller feeders. I've got some here.
Tell you what, Dave, you're doing well on the examples today.
I got it all out of my van. So there's like the little ICM system. I mean, that's a lot neater, isn't it? Like your ICS, because obviously the stems are smaller, they're not as long. But that obviously you're a bit limited. Well, you can use a pellet feeder or the little method, which are them two. But no, really, stick with it. Don't worry about it. I've used it. I've gone there, you know, fishing with a little pellet feeder, and I'm going, oh, I'll chuck a bomb over the top and I'll just put a 30 gram cube on that stem, chuck it out, and straight round.
It's worth saying you're normally using a longer hook length anyway, aren't you?
So don't worry. I mean, they're the stems. I've just been doing some of these every day. Look, these are the elasticated stems. I mean, that's the sort of stem that I use for all my ICS. I've been elasticating them. Mm-hmm. I've been doing what Neil McKinnon, fair claim, Neil McKinnon put on his Facebook page about what not to use. So get this on here. Absolutely brilliant. And I have started using more elasticated stems. Recently, I've cut off two, you know, the top kit things you get with your pole. I got some 14s and 12s in there. When I was going to Tobber, I started using elasticated stems. And,
Nice.
Just put a cube on it, no problem at all.
Nice one. Right, Jeff Ball says thanks again. Another one who says thanks.
Jeff.
He says he's looking to tie his own hook lengths for the first time at the moment. And he says, is there a general rule of thumb to what hook size to line down at, i.e. 16 to 018?
Well, that depends on, like I said earlier, about the GPM question. That's why we kept the spades a nice size. Because, like I said, if you go back to some of the older style hooks, you know, they were strong hooks, but the spade was too small. But I would say... it's very difficult to answer that question because obviously you've got different, like an SFL. Well, I would say an SFL would take up to in an 18 would take up to 012, Joe.
Yeah.
I would say if you went up to 014, you'd struggle to get it on. Where if you went to a GPM, which is what GPM basically stands for, general purpose
match
fishing,
medium match. General purpose medium,
and I can tie an 18 to a 15 power line. So it's a hard question to answer because it depends on what hooks you're using. If I use a GPM as an example, like an 18, I would say you could tie 015 on an 18. But obviously, if you're just starting out, I would go to 013 power line maximum because you'll tie it nice and easy. When you go to a 16, you can go up to like 015. And if you go to a 14, that will take sort of 017. So if you use a GPM to start with your hooks, like I said, an 18, you can go 011, 013, nice. If you step up to a 16, you can fish 011, 013, and 015. And if you go to a 14, obviously you can go 011, 013, 015, and 017. Obviously, you're not going to really tie that on 011 because you're not going to be fishing 011 and 14, really, unless you want a pile of bream or something. Yeah. But there's no, it depends on the size of the spade. That's what it depends on. And that's why on the GPM, we kept the spade a nice size. So when you tie your hooks, it's a lot easier. Mm-hmm. So if you stick off with a GPM, have a go, and you'll soon get into, like, you'll know what it will take, what the spade will take. And the GPM, like I said, is general purpose match. So really, whatever you're doing, that hook covers a lot of your fishing.
Yeah. Nice one. Right, we're going to go three more, Des, because we are well over an hour now. Let me pick some good ones. Right, Gary Jenkins says, can you talk us through the different tips that you get with feeder rods, i.e. 1.5, 2 ounce, so on? What are the advantages and disadvantages of using each, and when is it best to use each one?
A good all-round tip, that cat. He tries to get through a door and it's shut. I mean, what a cat. A general purpose tip for me is 1.5 ounce. That is like the all-rounder, I would say, whether you're fishing for a normal feeder, a method feeder, pellet feeder, bomb. It's just a perfect tip. When I start fishing sort of 2-3 ounce tips, that's a lot of that is to do with distance and I'm fishing for good quality fish. And also the tow on the lake. If you go to a real big lake and you know it tows, you might have to fish 2 to 3 ounces. There's no point sitting there having your tip bent like round. You know, you want it so you can actually see the bite. When you go down to real light tips, like 3/4 ounce, 1/2 ounce, I mean, that's more down to smaller fish, seeing the delicate moon. I know, Joe, you fished hayfield during the winter, didn't you?
Yeah, half ounce every
and
time.
I spoke to Joe at meetings and he said, look, 1/2 ounce made a huge difference. But that was down to bite, wasn't it?
It was basically because the fish was so, obviously the water was freezing cold and they just don't move. So yeah. You're getting literally that on the tip and that is your bite a lot of the time. So
yeah, I would... Really, the way I look at it, if I go to...
is that cat again?
No, I want the cat. Cat's gone in. Mrs. let the cat in. If I go to Shearwater, for example, I'm fishing like 50, 60, 70, 80 metres. There's no point me fishing a 1.5 ounce tip. I need to get it out there. I'm fishing with like a 12-6 distance master rod. I fish 3 ounce tips. You know, I'm not fishing for these delicate bites. I'm fishing with a method feeder. You know, the bites are all sorts of bites. Some of them are like little taps like that, and they're sort of on, and some of them are proper pull rounds. Some of them are dropbacks. So, but that a lot of that is distance and what I'm fishing with. I'm fishing for good-sized fish. I'm fishing with like a method feeder. I want to get it out where I'm fishing. You know, normal commercial fishing for me, if you look at all my little Tysons, little Superior rods, they've all got 1.5 ounce tips. It's the perfect all-round tip for casting anywhere from 20 meters to 40, you know, 40 odd meters. Brilliant. And then obviously when you start going down to 1 ounce to 3/4 ounce, I think that's more like what Joe was talking about, was more about skimmer fishing, you know, whether that's summer or winter, and you're looking for real shy biting fish, basically skimmers. But if you stick with 1.5 ounces, normally that will see you through on it on 90% of your fishing.
Yeah, definitely. Right, two more. Right, there's a good one here. This is from Colin Burgess.
Yeah.
Hi, Des. I'm not fully abled, so I look in horror at the amount of kit that matchmen carry. And he tries to do a few matches despite you know, the situation. But he says, what is the minimum amount of kit that I could take and still be competitive, you know, still get a section win? Mm-hmm. He uses a barrow, but that is still, you know, hard work for him. So,
yeah, all right, Colin. Yeah, good. Yeah, it's a great question. I think you can cut it right down. Mm-hmm. I really do. I mean, you look at my box setup the other day, you don't have to take two side trays. Take one if you want to, you know. You definitely need a side tray. You definitely need a feeder arm or some sort of variation of a feeder arm, because if you feed a fish in, it's really important. I think, like, the keep net, the arm, the utility arm, whatever it was I put on, or I can carry on my box, and what it's called now. What's that toolbar bar called? Yeah. Toolbar. But you can buy a small, you can get a small toolbar. Mm-hmm. You don't have to have the big one. You can have one that takes two keep nets. So it just fits over one of your box legs, and it's got two of the little snap locks on it, and you can have two. So that cuts down on weight, cuts down what you're taking to your peg. I think it's just thinking about it. It's, I can't sort of point out everything, but like, as for minimum, really, you just need your box. You need a few rigs. You know, like I said before, on these, get yourself a nice little selection of floats like that in a tray. I ain't been funny. For most people on commercials, a tray like that with different, you know, different main lines, it's going to cover you for so much of your fishing. So yeah, two of them, it weighs nothing. Get it to your peg, it's job done. So you don't have to carry tons and tons of rigs if you don't want to. If you know what venue you're going to, you know, just carry two of them. It's nice, you know, the same sort of float, the float you're not, you know, you get on with. But just do it on different main lines. And that's what I do, try and keep it, you know, down. You know, you've got your little ICS feeder system. You can have a couple of feeders. It's easy. Mm. You just got to try and cut. Now, if I wanted to, I could cut my gear right down if I knew where I was going. But because I go to lots of different venues, I just think, oh, sod it, I'll leave it. And, you know, and that's it, really. It's a tough question to sort of get through, but I think you just got to think about, you know, like all that off box stuff and that. Oh, it's so, you know, it's so easy to sort of have as much as you want, and also cutting it right back if you want to.
I think it's interesting as well, like how you fish and Lee fishes, you know, you have everything around you because you've got that international background and you like having everything tan. But on the flip side of that, Andy Finley barely has anything on his box, and he's competitive. So
yeah. I mean, I do like a nice setup. You know, I like things to hand, and I don't want to be getting off my box as much as, you know, as much as possible. I want everything around me, you know. And we all fish in different ways. It is such a tough question to sort of say, you know, what do you take? It's just take the most important things. You know, like you've got to have a side tray. Mm-hmm. What you don't want you to do is have your gear or your bait down. You know, you want a nice side tray, nice and sturdy, you know. You definitely got to have something for your keep nets to go on, even whether it's one of those big accessory bars or whether it's one of the small accessory bars. That makes a lot of difference. You know, a lot of these things nowadays, they cut down on gear anyway. Mm. I remember what I, you know, to take four or five keep nets years ago, I'd have like four of those great big double extending bank sticks. Yeah, it's cut, that's gone.
Yeah, it's all gone, isn't it?
You know, it's all gone. So it has cut down anyway. But yeah, it's a tough one. Tough one to answer, Colin. I think you just got to think about it a little bit. You know, a little box, you know, a little inception box. You can get most of that, you can get in your box on that bottom of your box, you know, your 150 mil tray.
Yeah.
You can get your rigs in it. Sure, you know, so much you can carry in just a box, you know. But it's a tough question.
Yeah, definitely. Tough, but
sort of get over, really.
I think we do carry a bit too much kit, don't we? But
I carry lots of kit, but I do fish lots of different venues. But if I just fish one venue every week, it'd be simple, you know.
There you go, Colin. So have a little think about it.
Yeah, it's tough, mate. Tough, that is. Have a look at my video I've done on my box and then try and just work the little things out from that. What you really, really need.
Yeah.
And take it from there.
Yeah. Nice one. Right. This is the last one, Des. It's from Andrew Kirtley. It says, Des, do you ever check your pond the fish's behaviour in your pond before leaving for a match to give you a clue of how they might be feeding?
No, because it doesn't matter what conditions it is.
Because it's red hot in your pond.
As soon as I touch the curtains or touch the handle of the door, they're over like piranhas. No, not really. They're tame. I've had some of the fish for 30 years, and no, it's absolute. The only thing I will say, which I've learned, not learned, but what I do see is they don't sometimes, there's several fish that sometimes don't feed. You can have all the rest of them feed, and there's a few on the bottom, especially this time of year, they go a little bit funny, whether that's to do with spawning. And I think, oh, there's something wrong with that fish. Starts to get you thinking, oh, Christ almighty, something's going to go wrong here. And the next day, it's up feeding again. Like it's just been, I don't know, it's had a day off. No, I can't learn nothing. The only thing I will say about, I mean, bearing in mind, my koi pond's gene clear. They are pretty damn stupid carp trying to get a sinking pellet. They're not like... If it was a roach or if it was a rudd or a chub or something like that, they're like pinpoint accuracy,
sharp, aren't they?
Sharp. You know, they're right on it. They're after it and they take it. Where a carp's like that. It's going all over the shot. And I think that's why you hook some of the fish around here. They're not as... I don't know. Even when I was watching them the last few days, I'm chucking some 4 mil pellets in, or sinking pellets, and I'm watching them on the bottom. They don't necessarily go to the pellet. They do see it, but they normally see it as it's dropping through that last few inches and they're on it. When it's actually led on the bottom, they're just chomping like that and then they pick it up. And it's amazing to watch. They can pick up, I mean, there might be some sort of fish crap on the bottom, which I don't like because obviously it's my koi pond. But the neighbours must be thinking I'm losing the plots. I'll be out there lying on the side of the pond. And there can be a 4 mil pellet and a pile of rubbish, you know, bits of leaves and that, and they'll pick the whole lot up and there's no way that that good pellet will come out. The whole lot comes out apart from that pellet. It's incredible. So, yeah. And their sense of smell is unbelievable. I can go out there at night and I can have the outside light come on and they're all sort of led on the bottom. Because it's quite cold at night at the moment, and I can chuck one pellet in there, and then all of a sudden, they're all off the bottom. They're all going around digging on the bottom like that, and one of the carp's obviously at the pellet, but then that smell of that pellet must be still on the bottom of the pond, and they're all hunting around that little area. And I've always said that in silt, when pellets are going silt. I've told the story before when I went over my local lake and I threw in 24 mil pellets and I caught like 30 pound of little skimmers, little F1s in that, and it was still fizzing. And I thought, there's no way them 20 pellets are still in my peg. Because of the smell of the pellets were in the silt, they still think it's there and they keep hunting for something that ain't there, basically. And I see that in my pond. And that pond is like the bottom is solid. There ain't no silt or anything. And that's the only sort of things that I've ever sort of thought. Carper, yeah, they're crafty, but they're not like roach and chub and things like that. They see a bait and go for it. Carp have actually got, when it's on the bottom, they do feel around for it more.
Yeah.
They're still crafty. They'll suck a bait in. They will suck some of it in and spit it out in a blink of an eye. Mm. If they think it ain't worth having, or if it's, you know, I've not hooked one. I'm not going to hook one. if they think something's wrong, they eject it so quick. It's unbelievable. It's like a blink of an eye. And like the bites I've always had about, these little things, you can see why. Because as they suck the bait in, it shoots in. It's like, whoop. You know, I think that's when you see that on your float a lot.
It's like a trap door, isn't it? It goes in.
Mm-hmm. But it comes out as fast as it went in.
I remember with my pond, Des, like I've got a pond at my dad's house and... In winter, it's not as sophisticated as your setup, but you could throw an old pellet in and they would not move. Yeah, you used to put Joker in when he used to go do a lot of blood and Joker fishing, and it'd be like that.
Yeah. I mean, I could chuck anything in there. I gave one a cheesy Watsit yesterday, which I shouldn't do.
Is that the secret to the colour?
One of my fish I've had for years is like not very, it's minging really. It's too old. It needs to go somewhere and retire.
Is that the ghosty?
Yeah, the ghosty. He's like, he's. But yeah, they'll eat anything in my pond, anything you chuck in there. But no, you do learn, you learn the things that, like, how they eject the bait, how they suck a bait in. And like I said, certain fish are very, very unique how they feed. You know, how the hell you catch these carp on the, you know, when you're tapping and you're picking your rig out, it's unbelievable. Because they ain't that, they're not that, like, on it. They must be like that. And then, you know, it's like, well, yeah, I've had that.
Yeah.
No, that's it, really. Not learn nothing, really, about keeping fish. No. Nothing at all.
Brilliant. All right, Des, there we go.
All right.
Another one. All right,
well, thanks for the comments. I said, everybody stay safe. Hopefully, we'll get the other side of this, and we'll try and do this every week. Hopefully, some of the questions that you've enjoyed, and keep them coming, and I'll keep on going as long as we can.
Brilliant. Cheers, Des.
Yeah, no worries. See you later. Bye, guys.